Good morning and welcome to Mount Carmel Church this morning. It's wonderful to see everyone and to be worshiping here with you this morning. And also those that are joining us on their phones, Zoom and YouTube. Welcome and thank you for, we're glad you're worshiping with us this morning. We did experience a little technical difficulty this morning where we're losing the internet in and out, so please stay tuned. If it does go out, it'll come back on again. We're praying. There's a few reminders this week. For missions, remember the shoeboxes must be at the church November 8th. Any questions, contact Patty Levengood. The virtual coffee hour on Wednesdays at 10 a.m. with your host, Judy Turner. Please join in. It's a great way to stay connected. We are all still looking for worship participants. There's several opportunities. Please contact Pastor Denny or leave a message at the church. Also, please remember to record your attendance at the end of the service. A note this morning. We all have needs from time to time that we are unable sometimes to fill. It could be that you need a ride to get your car inspected, store at a at the supermarket, or a ride to the pharmacy for your meds. Sometimes we just need a little help. Please contact the church, Pastor Denny, or myself, and we'll see how we can help out. That goes for our congregation and also the community. Please pray this morning for all those on our prayer list. One we want to add is Debbie and Harry Whited's granddaughter, Megan Pratt. She's struggling with teenage issues. Please keep her in your thoughts and prayers. Birthdays this week on Friday is Dot Cannell. Happy birthday, Dot. Also on Friday, celebrating anniversaries are Darcel and Carl Ryder and Debbie and Scott Demet. Does anyone have any announcements for the good of the church? Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Let us pray. Jesus, you are our example of how to have perfect trust in the Father. We want what you have and know it's available for us too, but only if we follow you. Help us to stay close to you, God. You are our lifeblood. You are our everything. It's by keeping our eyes focused on you that our trust develops fuller. Please help us stay close to you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. The first hymn this morning is number 92, For the Beauty of the Earth. Please join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed, the affirmation of our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's pray together. God, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving for your faithful love. Your love never fails. Not even when we turn away from you, when we ignore your invitation or desert you for gods of our own making. Even then, you do not abandon us, but reach out again and again, inviting us back into the relationship once more. As you welcome us, so you welcome our prayers. We bring them to you with confidence, knowing that you will hear and answer. We pray for the world you created and the people who share it with us, for countries caught up in war or violent conflict, for regions of the world struggling with increased cases of COVID-19, for those whose homes and lives are threatened by natural disaster, for these and all the other areas in our world where there is need and despair. And we pray for our country and for its people, for our government leaders, federal and local, for our judicial system, police forces and military, for our cities, towns and rural communities, for employers and employees, for young and old, for all who are a part of this great country. We pray for our local community, the people of this and surrounding townships, for those who are unemployed, for those in prison, especially for Michael Blake and his family today, for those who are hungry, for those who are alone and afraid, for all of our neighbors, both known and unknown to us. We pray for this congregation, our brothers and sisters in Christ, for those who are ill and whose loved ones are ill, for those who are anxious about the future, for those struggling with their faith, for those who minister among us, for all your people in this place. Pour out your spirit on us. Fix our hearts and minds on what is true and honorable and right. Give us the joy and peace that comes from knowing and doing your will. Keep us faithful to the call we have received in Christ Jesus our Lord, extending your loving invitation to the world around us. And now, Lord, we pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 10. The people saw that Moses was taking a long time to come down from the mountain. They gathered around Aaron and said to him, Come on, make us gods who can lead us. As for this man Moses who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we don't have a clue what has happened to him.
Aaron said to them,
All right, take out the gold rings from the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me. So all the people took out the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron.
He collected them
and tied them up in a cloth. Then he made a metal image of a bull calf, and the people declared, These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf. Then Aaron announced, Tomorrow will be a festival to the Lord.
He got up early the next day
and
offered up in holy banner offerings and brought well-being sacrifices to the people sat down and they got up to celebrate. The Lord spoke to Moses, "Hurry up and go down. Your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt are ruining everything. They have made a metal bull. They bowed down to it and offered sacrifices to it and declared, 'These are our gods, brought us up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I've been watching these people, and I've seen how stubborn they are.
Now leave me alone. Let my food burn and devour them. Then I'll make the great nation of you." That ends our reading.
So let's begin
our conversation this morning on this text of Exodus 32, beginning with verse 1 and going through verse 10. It's only a part of the narrative that talks about the Exodus from Egypt. Where we pick it up is Egypt's behind the Israelites. That is to say, they've left it. The army, Egyptian army's been defeated by God, who guided them on their whole journey. God's provided food and water. And here they are at Mount Sinai, also known as Horeb. This is the place where Moses had his first encounter with God in the burning bush and was called to the ministry of liberation that sent him back to Egypt to bring a slave population into freedom. Moses went up to the mountain where he originally met Yahweh, and he spent 40 days and 40 nights according to the scripture. Now, our scholars suggest to us that in fact that probably was not 40 24-hour days or nights. It was probably, that the text, whenever that you see that, it means a long time. And if you think about what's happened here, it probably had to be a long time. Anyhow, it was long enough that Moses was absent from the people that they began to get impatient. Remember, before Moses led them out of Egypt, he was one of the Egyptians. So could they trust him? They did for a while when he actually got them thrown out of Egypt, liberated, if you will. The penalties for the plagues were so great that the Egyptians basically said, "Leave, get out of here." But now Moses is gone. And what they have is his brother, who is not the same leader as Moses. And so with their leader gone, the people begin to deal with their anxiety. They begin to fear. Where's our leader? He's not visible. That's kind of interesting that this text comes up, and I think about it recently because we all long to see our president, see him healthy. Well, that's the same kind of anxiety that the Israelites were feeling. You see, they wanted something they knew rather than the unknown. So they say to Aaron, Moses' brother, "Make us gods who can lead us." And totally abandon the God who brought them out of the land of Egypt. They say, "As for this man Moses, who brought us up out of the land, we don't have a clue what's happened to him. He must be dead." So they want a replacement. They want somebody who will lead, who will provide some direction for them. Aaron, sensing, I believe, that this is a very difficult situation and probably one of rebellion if he's not careful, concedes to their wishes. So he directs them, "Take out the gold rings from the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." Now, you know, the fact of the matter was these were slaves, so they had very little. The Egyptians did actually pay them to leave, They gave them gold things, probably these very rings which they had. You remember, they've been in the wilderness a while. And as they did that, the people declared, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." And early the next day, they offered up entirely burnt offerings and brought well-being sacrifices. And the people sat down to eat and drink and make merry. Now, it's interesting, and I have to admit, as many times as I've read these texts, I've never noticed this one. It stood out to me in a different way than it has any other time that I've read it. Because the text says, when Aaron saw this, when Aaron saw the celebration, he built an altar in the front of the calf. And then he announced, "Tomorrow will be a festival to the Lord." Even in the midst of that celebration that they're having, Aaron begins to call the people back to faithfulness in Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, way up on that mountain, it must have been a great party, because the text says that God and Moses heard the celebration. Moses probably didn't hear what was going on, just a lot of noise. But God heard, and God gets angry. And the Lord speaks to Moses, "Hurry up and go down. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, are ruining everything." Now, what's that mean? God had an intimate relationship with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We've talked about that in the last couple of weeks. And now, when God is pulling them back and doing miraculous things for them, opening the Red Sea, defeating the Egyptian army, providing water out of stones and manna from the sky, when there's an intimate relationship which God desires to have with his people, but it's broken because the people are focused elsewhere. The people are making for themselves other gods. Scripture says they were ruining everything. What they were ruining was that relationship. Now, God says, "They've already abandoned the path I've commanded. They've made a metal bull calf for themselves. They've bowed down to it and offered sacrifices to it and declared, 'These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" Well, the fact is that they paid a price for that, even at that moment. They gave up some of their wealth, lost some of the booty they brought from Egypt, and they fashioned it, Aaron fashioned it for that matter, into an idol of a bull calf, which took the place of God. You see, they were willing to sacrifice of their possessions. And that's an important piece, because they were slaves, so they didn't have really a lot of money or a lot of possessions. They even lived off the land to this point in their journey for something that would take God's place. This bull calf was known to them. Now, as I read this text, it occurred to me that that's what idols do. They really focus us not on God, but away from God. They replace God with something else that takes the rightful place of God, and they become false gods. That got me thinking. What are our golden calves? I'm relatively sure that there's none of us in this room and probably online who go to worship a golden calf. Not literally. But do we have golden calves we don't recognize? It doesn't have to be something tangible. It can be. I remember a family that during a hunting accident, their only son at 12 or 13 years old was shot fatally by his father. And they really never got over the grief. And so they set up a shrine in his bedroom. And nobody was allowed to go into the bedroom without some sense of reverence. And their lack of ability to get beyond the grief caused them to move, to even buy a new house, and to move into it, to get rid of some of the memories. But do you know what they did? They took that bedroom, that shrine, and moved it intact to the new house. You see, we get we create these idols that sometimes we don't even recognize. But whatever takes the place that rightfully belongs to God, for which we are willing to sacrifice what is of value to us, whatever demands our loyalty, that becomes idolatrous. Whatever requires our loyalty that belongs to God makes us idolatrous. I was interested in some sermons I recently read by Martin Luther King Jr. They were delivered in July of 1953. And in those sermons, in 3 weeks, Martin Luther King Jr. identified three false gods. First of all, he preached on the false god of science. We know that science provides many things, many good things. The research of science provides vaccinations and medical discoveries that make life better. It's produced improvement in building materials and engineering that allow us to erect buildings hundreds of feet into the sky. As I write this and as I say this, it kind of reminds me of the Tower of Babel. Science has provided an increase in food production, so that in September 2007, an article was published that we were able to feed all of the world's population at that point. And yet there are still some who are hungry. Science has provided products that were conceived 10 years ago. And when they were, they increased pollution of the air we breathe, which has resulted in lung cancer and a change in nature's behavior, to name just a couple of things. It was interesting for me to hear during the recent pandemic and during the lockdown that birds changed their songs in cities because there was no noise to compete with them. They could sing softer. And maybe that love song that they were singing just happened to go a little better. Nuclear energy has produced X-rays, radiation treatment, and the ability to annihilate civilization. Now, those are all King's words. I'll come back to some in a minute. Man today, right now, as in 1953, stands on the brink of atomic destruction, aghast, panic-stricken, and petrified. Today, the doomsday clock, which talks about how close we are to global annihilation through nuclear war or nuclear explosion, has the clock set. It used to be 10 minutes to 12 or 5 minutes to 12. Today, it sets at 100 seconds to 12. And there's a sense in which we carry that all around with us. We all wonder what's happening in North Korea. We wonder what's happening across the Atlantic Ocean in the countries that we've always had attention with, or most of the time have had attention with. Now, the second false god that Martin Luther King Jr. identified, he talked about in a sermon on July 12, 1953. He said the second false god is that of nationalism. Now, we're all familiar with the creed of this new religion, he said. It affirms that each nation is an absolute sovereign unit, acknowledging no control save its own independent will. The watchword for this new religion, and he quoted, "My country, right or wrong." He said, and the new religion has its familiar prophets and preachers. Just getting over World War II, it was In Germany, it was Hitler. In Italy, it was Mussolini. And in America in 1953, it was preached by McCarthy and the advocates of white supremacy and America's and the America First movement. Now, the fact is that one cannot worship this false god of nationalism and the god of Christianity at the same time. Because there's a difference, folks, between patriotism and nationalism. The two are working with worshiping God and worshiping our country and dealing with nationalism are incompatible. And all the dialects of the logicians cannot make them exist together. We've got to choose whom we will serve. And we recognize that that was part of what Joshua said to his people once they were in the promised land. Choose today whom you will serve. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. The same decisions are ours. Will we continue to serve the false gods of that places absolute national sovereignty first? Or will we serve the God in whom there is no east or west, as we sing so often? The third idol, the third God, a false God that Martin Luther King talked about, and he did it in a July 19, 1953 sermon, was money. Now, this is a really subtle one. He says, we're always writing scripture to read. Now, I want to quote the verse the way it's written in scripture. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the rest will be yours as well. King suggested that we're rewriting it to say, seek first money and its power, and all those other things will be added to you. Or money is my light and my salvation. What shall I fear? And when you think about where we are in all our culture, that even during this pandemic, the richest people in America saw their income and their wealth grow while others were out of work. Just turn on the television and listen to the radio. You can find TV hawkers, people who are pushing pyramid sales organizations, and preachers who promise riches or miracles if you send them some money. They sell quick, get-rich-quick techniques. I'm always interested in the folks who will talk about not being taken in by magicians. You know, we know that magic is basically sleight of hand. I love to watch Fool Us, which is one of the great musicians, two of the great magicians in our country, Penn and Teller. And they have new magicians come in and tell them how they did the trick. Now, the fact of the matter is you'll never understand how they did it unless you're a magician, because they use code when they talk to them. But the point is that they sometimes are fooled, but they know they're being fooled. You see, and then I hear preachers who are saying, now all you need to do is send me $20, I'll send you my magic prayer cloth. And you can put it over your elbow or over your joint that aches. And just with that $20, you know, it'll get better. Now listen, I believe that God is able to heal us. The problem is that we're frequently taken in because we want to get better. People give in. People give so that they can get back. Now, I happen to have to confess that as a stewardship consultant, I've used that passage of Luke that says, give and it'll be given to you, full measure, pressed down, shaken together, for the measure you give will be the measure you get back. I don't think it says give to get. I don't think that's the intention of that passage. I think it describes what in fact happens, that generous people are rewarded. Sometimes they're rewarded in different ways. But anyhow, we get caught up with trying to make ends meet and even beyond while we give up on making a life. And the reality is that we live in a world where sometimes just to pay the bills takes one family member working in three jobs just to keep the kids at school, the lights on and food on the table. So I ask you, are we any better off as a country than we were 80 years ago? The reality is that we need money to sustain our families and pay our bills. I don't condemn anyone who's worked hard or even inherited their wealth for having it. At the same time, when we justify getting more wealth at the expense of others, when we fight paying a minimum wage so we can make more, when the cost of health care is prohibitive for so many of our brothers and sisters, while Big Pharma pays doctors to push its products and raise the cost of necessary medications like insulin beyond the place where people can afford them. Think about how they put more on the backs of people who are already sick and really don't have a choice about what they can do. Then, friends, we must confront the idol of money. Science, nationalism, and money should not be our gods, and certainly they are not our saviors. The problem we face is that that which we worship becomes our gods, and our goals and our gods inform our ethics and our behavior because they form our values. Idols rob the allegiance we owe to God. What we as Christians owe to God is siphoned off by other values. Aaron, at least, I believe, understood that when he gave in to the crowd. Really, what choice did he have? He was faced with rebellion. So as soon as he saw that his people were attributing what belonged to Yahweh to a powerless golden image of a bull, and let me say a word about bulls here in Egyptian culture. Bulls by the Egyptians were associated with the Pharaoh who sometimes took on the epithet of strong bull of his mother. Much like the sacred cows of India, in Egypt, they were considered often sacred because they were believed to be an incarnation of a god and were provided with plush quarters, given only the best food, and provided with a harem of the best cows. Aaron didn't believe that they replaced God, nor should they. Aaron observed the worship and the celebration of liberation accredited to the great bull god, and immediately he called the people back to Yahweh. Verse 5 says, when Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf. Think about that. Even while they're worshiping the calf, Aaron builds an altar to redirect them. And then he announced, tomorrow will be a festival to the Lord. You may be here today, but tomorrow we're going to worship the Lord. We know that God and Moses heard the party. And God gets angry and is ready to destroy them. And that's another story, another week we could talk about that. But here's the thing on this text. Learning new behavior is difficult. Think about it. For all of their lives, because they were Israel was in Egypt for 400 years. So there's no one who was coming out of Egypt who knew anything but the worship that the Egyptians put forth, and they're being asked to change their behavior. They were raised with bull calf gods of Egypt. And when Moses took so long in his communion with Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all of whom were distant, if any, memories in the history of this people being released from slavery, they did what they knew how to do. And that's, frankly, one of the things that I've learned. When people don't know what to do, they do what they know how to do, and they go back to the comfortable. You see, the Israelites thought that they were lost. They didn't see a future for themselves as they had no water or food, or they were in the middle of the desert of nowhere. And this God seemed to be a myth. They couldn't see him. And though they experienced his power, they went back to what was comfortable. When we don't know what to do, we do what we know how to do. When we are uncomfortable, we look for comforting things. The state of the COVID-19 pandemic is a current illustration of that. Despite the fact what we want is most important is to get back to normal, many folks would sacrifice that for the comfort and normalcy of not wearing a mask or fighting occupancy restrictions. Now, I've got to be honest. I'd just as soon not be wearing a mask. But I know that when I do, it not only protects me, more often than not, it also protects you. And that's really important, to wear them correctly, to provide social distancing. Because the one thing we do know is as we go further into the winter, and we're seeing it already, the number of people with COVID-19 is going to increase. So we're willing to sacrifice the very thing we want because we have misguided loyalties. We just want things to be the way they were because, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we knew what we left, and the fear of the unknown is overwhelming. Like the Israelites, the future lies ahead of us. The probability is that we will never return to where we were prior to March 1st, 2020. The world's changed. Our culture's changed. Our church has changed. We've gotten almost 9 months older in the meantime. We have new aches and pains. We have new hopes. We have new economic conditions. And we don't see our Moses or God. So we are tempted to abandon the future for a past that doesn't exist anymore, except in our memories. Maybe that's our punishment for a people, to be so tempted to worship other gods than Jesus, who is our Redeemer, that we always want to go back and never follow him forward. God who leads us, God who was leading Israel, wants them to move, and he moves. Are we being left behind? You see, what we need is an examination of our lives and our priorities and our values so that we can live a Jesus life. God's laws are not arbitrary or temporary. They're universal and permanent. And the reality is, when we go back to that understanding of science being so important, and money and nationalism, the fact of the matter is that they don't provide the values for long-term viability. God's laws are universal and permanent for all time, for all people. 1,800 years after the commandments were written, John, in his first letter, chapter 5, verse 21, says, "Little children, guard yourselves from idols." The first and second commandments sound similar, but they really are different. The first commandment tells us not to worship the wrong God. The second tells us not to worship the right God the wrong way. So let's test and examine our ways and cleanse our lives of idols that have crept into them. Yahweh is the only God that deserves and commands our loyalty. And living our faith in him, who gives us abundantly through mercy and grace and forgives us all of our shortcomings, is what we're called to do, to live a Jesus life. So, brothers and sisters, let us test and examine our ways and see if there's any wicked way within us, any gods that we worship, anything that distracts us or is contrary to the God who called us, saved us, and loves us. Let's pray together. Lord our God, you who made us and who loves us even when we turn from you, we're grateful that you don't give up on us. Forgive us for those times that we have turned our backs on you because we sought immediate gratification. Lord, we sometimes abandon you for immediate solutions rather than living through the long-term fixes of our lives and for our lives. Forgive us, we pray, when we've allowed other gods to invade our lives and take the place that rightfully belongs to you. Like the Israelites in the wilderness, we need you to remake us into your people. Hear our prayer for forgiveness and our resolve to be more faithful. We pray in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. And now receive the benediction. Go from here with joy to love and serve God and one another. And may the blessings of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be among you and within you. And the blessings and protection of God Almighty protect you and your relationship with Him as you struggle with living your life for Him. Amen.